And the Marine Mammal Center is a pretty unique place. We're the world's largest marine mammal hospital. So we rehabilitate on average 500, 600 animals a year. And that includes mostly seals and sea lions, occasionally a whale, a dolphin, a porpoise, or an otter. And we rehabilitate those animals and try to get them back out into the ocean. At the same time, it also allows us an educational opportunity. We can use those different specimens like bones and pelts and baleen to teach students and the general public about marine mammals and how they can take care of the ocean environment and help those marine mammals survive. Here is a live mount of a sea otter mom and pup. So this is the position that the mother will often swim, and she'll often put her pup on her belly while she feeds the pup and wraps herself up in kelp, or wraps the pup up in kelp to keep it afloat. They have a very dense coat of fur. They have the thickest coat of any animal on Earth, and there's about a million hairs in one little square inch. The elephant seals are born in January typically, and they weigh about 75 pounds at birth. And after 1 month of being with their mom, they should weigh 300 pounds. Both of these pups are probably 3 weeks to 4 weeks old, so they should have been weaned. But at this point, they're extremely underweight. They both weigh maybe about 50 pounds. You'll notice a couple of things. One, those marks, the green and red marks on their head. We put a little grease pencil on their head that helps us tell who's who. And it's easier when we're giving them medicine and food. You'll also notice the orange flipper tags on their backs. And those orange flipper tags on their hind flippers help us tell who's who. And those are left on the animal after they're released. So one's named Umby, and the other one's named Gee Willikers. And they're given those names by the folks that rescue them off the beach. And there we have Porter and Tiny Tim. Tiny Tim is the one who is the escape artist. So what we're doing with that animal is we just moved it. She is suffering from domoic acid. And domoic acid is something that we see in California sea lions. It's basically a biotoxin that's been transferred up the food chain. So she's eaten some anchovies or sardines that may have eaten some toxic plankton or diatoms. And when those get up the food chain, they become concentrated. And the animals often suffer from seizures. So she's been here for several months. She is still suffering from seizures. So if we're unable to get an animal better if they can't survive in the wild, we then contact zoos and aquariums to see if they would want to take the animal on. We'll be right back.
I think the winters here in the Headlands are amazing because there's nothing that shows you the power and dramatic nature, dramatic forces of nature like the winter. When the winter storms come and hit the Headlands, the large waves are just magnificent. That crash over the beach and make the beach completely disappear.
I think that for me, it's that the Headlands is a place where you have to slow down a little more and you have to look a little closer. And then when you do that, you'll see pretty amazing things. There's this beautiful open space on the edge of the continent with this beautiful ocean that's flowing by, and the wildflowers are blooming in the springtime and the hawks are migrating in the fall, and it just gives us a chance to recognize what's happening around us, connect with what's around us, and to just remember to take the time to appreciate it.
If someone's watching a red-tailed hawk, they're not just coming out here to work with the Golden Gate Raptor Observatory because they have a hawk fix that they need to have every so often. A lot of our folks come out because, in fact, they're getting a very deep level of healing out here and a deep level of peace, mm-hmm. and in some ways an ability to survive mm-hmm. in an urban area that we can't take mm-hmm. for granted. So it's a real essence of the Headlands for me.
I think that there are several lessons that this land can offer us, and I won't be able to say them all in one interview because it's something that happens over time when you can be in touch with a wild place. When you can get to know a wild place through the seasons and year after year, which is a great gift that we have out here, you change. You are reminded daily that you're just part of this larger process. That you're a very small speck in this larger process. And I think that is an important lesson for all of us to remember as we move through our very complex, very fast-paced world, that we're still a part of it, that we're still an animal. We are part of the animal kingdom. And regardless of our brain and our mental capacity that makes us unique as Homo sapiens, we're still animals, and we are still dependent on this bubble of a planet, this blue and green planet that gives us everything we have. And by remembering that we're part of the animal kingdom, it reminds us in a cycle that you have to give back everything you have, just as it gives. Mm-hmm.